Evaluation, if we look at, is basically the process of systematically determining the relative worth of jobs to create a job structure for the organization. Later on, when we see as to how Sixth Pay Commission really dealt with it and how they did it. But if you go through literature, what we find is that the wage and salary is normally fixed, taking into consideration five major factors. First, a factor is the capacity of the organization to pay. The second factor is, of course, the worth of job that is determined through job evaluation. The third factor is governmental regulation in vogue, that is, whichever land we are talking about. The fourth factor is the market rate or what competitors are paying. And the fifth factor is the economic, overall economic condition of the country. Right? Now, let us look at job evaluation as one of the exercises that is being done by the organization before they take into consideration other factors and then determine the of the job. Economy, when we look at, is basically looking at as to what is the state of inflation in the country and what should be the amount that a person should be paid to survive the onslaught of the dearest.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
So are you changing the slides?
No, I have not yet changed the slides.
Okay, sir.
The evaluation is based on a combination of job content, skills required, value to the organization, organizational culture, and external market. Now just see, the evaluation is not done in isolation. It is based on combination of job content, skill required, value of the organization, organizational culture, and external market condition. This potential to blend internal forces and external market forces is both a strength and challenge to the job evaluators. What we have is, we have got to align things, establish the purpose of evaluation, decide whether to use single or multiple plans, choose among alternative approaches, obtain involvement of relevant stakeholders, and evaluate the plans successfully. That is what is being given here. But there are certain assumptions for job evaluation that we have got to learn. Example, if you look at a measure of job content, then the content has an innate value outside of external market. A measure of relative value, that is, relevant groups can reach consensus on a relative value of the job. It has to be linked to external market. Job worth cannot be specified without external market information. That is, similar jobs in other industries, that is there. And measurement device would be honing instrument, which provide objective measures. And negotiation, of course, is the political process that we have got to see, and what is the state of the union, so on and so forth. There are large number of job content approaches that is there. We have got single versus multiple plans. We have which job evaluation method, which compensable factors to consider, how many factors will be considered, all or only key variables, number of definitions of degrees that is there, how many points to allow, relative weight of the factors, how to allocate point across factors and degrees, benchmark to evaluate, and who evaluates. These are the things that we have got to take a decision about. Now, job evaluation method, if you look at, there are many methods in vogue. The first method listed here is job ranking, which is the raters examine job description and arrange jobs according to value to the company. Now, this is not value to outside. Which job is the most important to which job is the least important in the organization? That is where the ranking is being done. Similarly, job classification is classes or grades are defined to describe a group of job. There are so many jobs which will be of equal worth, they will be grouped together. That is not possible in the ranking method. In ranking method, only one job will be ranked after the other. Whereas in classification, you will have the groups of jobs. And mostly, if you look at the jobs, they are of similar nature. I think I was just talking about the job that evaluation that is being done and clubbing of the job. I look at the job in the university system, which is before all of you. You have the job of assistant professor. You have the job of assistant librarian. You have the job of assistant registrar. They are all on the similar level, right? So they are clubbed together. Similarly, if you look at the job of a research assistant, you look at the job of section officer, or you look at the job of a senior technical assistant, they are considered to be almost at the same level, and therefore they attract the same amount of value. Now, the third method is referred to as the point method, where numerical values are assigned to specific job contents or components. Sum of the value provides quantitative assessment of job's worth. This is called Hay-Guyde chart profile method. Now, advantage of these three methods are that ranking is fast, simple, easy to explain, but disadvantage is that it is cumbersome as the number of job increases and basis for comparison is not called out. A classification method can group a wide range of job work together in one system, but description may leave too much room for manipulations that is there. Similarly, point method is compensable factors call out basis for comparisons, and compensable factors communicate what it is, but can become bureaucratic and rule bound as far as the point method is concerned. Now, the steps that is to be taken in the point plan process. Step one is conduct job analysis. Job analysis that we have done earlier in the second unit. A representative sample of benchmark jobs are to be identified. Which jobs are to be benchmarked, and all others will be arranged according to, either with them or will be ranked taking into consideration the benchmark jobs. The content of these jobs is based for compensable factors on the work performed, what is done. Based on strategy and value of the organization, what is valued and acceptable to those affected by resulting pay structure, what is acceptable to the job incumbents. The third step is scale the factors, that is, use examples to anchor. And fourth will be weight the factor that can reflect judgment of organizational leaders committee, can reflect a negotiated structure, that is a negotiation with the unions, can reflect a market-based structure, that is when you compare with the job with the market conditions. Now, step five will be apply to non-benchmark jobs. Now, characteristics of a benchmark job would be the contents are well-known and relatively stable and agreed upon by the employee involved. The supply and demand of these jobs are relatively stable. They represent the entire job structure under study. Majority of workforce is employed in these jobs. A compensable factor definition would be that compensable factors are paid for measurable qualities, features, requirements, or construct that are common to many different kinds of jobs. These factors are qualities intrinsic to the job and must be addressed in an acceptable manner if the job is to be performed satisfactorily. Now, in addition to being quantifiable, compensable factor should be relatively easy to describe and document. Those involved in using compensable factors to measure job worth should consistently arrive at similar results when they apply it to it several times. Now, there are certain factors which are universal compensable factors that we must know. For example, if you look at a skill, it is universal compensable factor. The experience, training, ability, and education required to perform a job under conditions consideration, not with the skill an employee may possess. Similarly, if you look at universal skills, that is technical know-how, specialized knowledge, organizational awareness, educational level, specialized training, years of experience required, interpersonal skills, and degree of supervision or supervisory skills required. Similarly, we have got effort is also one of the factors. The measurement of the physical or mental exertion needed for performing of a job. That is diversity of task, complexity of task, creativity of thinking, analytical problem solving, physical application of skills and degree of assistance available to the person who is performing the job. Similarly, we also have got responsibility as yet another factor. The extent to which an employer depends on the employee to perform the job as expected, with emphasis on the importance of the job obligations. Now here, decision-making authority, the scope of the organization under control, the scope of organizational impacted, degree of integration of work with others, impact of failure or risk of jobs, ability to perform tasks without supervision is coming under this particular category. Then we also have got compensable factor as hazards, that is the working conditions in which hazards is one, physical surroundings in which the job has to be performed. Those are the things which will be the working condition that has to be taken as into consideration while considering the compensable factor. Then you have got universal factors, that is in working condition, potential hazards inherent in the job. For example, a flying job is considered as a hazardous job, or deep sea diving is considered as a hazardous job, or if somebody working in the nuclear factory would be considered as hazardous jobs. Somebody working in the mines will be something called hazardous jobs, but somebody working elsewhere on the shores will not be considered as so hazardous. Now, similarly, we have degree of danger which can be exposed to others. We have impact of a specialized motor or concentration skills required. Degree of discomfort, exposure, or dirtiness in the job, doing the job, that is also would be there. This is to facilitate the use of compensable factors within a job evaluation method. It is common practice to classify the factors into three major categories: universal factor, sub-factors, and degrees of levels. Now, examples of HAY system that we saw earlier is know-how, that is practical, specialized, and technical breadth of management and human relations, and problem solving would be technical, thinking environment and thinking challenges that is there. Now, accountability is the freedom to act, that is magnitude, impact, remote, contributory, shared, and primary. Similarly, how many points to allow, that will be relative weight of the factors, how to allocate points across factors and degrees. We will also, given here, job factors are education, responsibility, physical effort, and working conditions. Now, they say that weightage would be 50% to education, 30% to responsibility, 12% to physical efforts, and 8% to working conditions. Why? Because a person where more education is required, they will be using more of mental faculty. Therefore, higher the education level, more would be the compensable factors weightage in terms of that, right? Similarly, responsibility comes next, that is assigned a 30%. This is hypothetical depending on the conditions of the job that is there. Now, who should be involved in the job evaluation? The design process matters. This is appeals review procedure. I know I speak for all of us when I say speak for all of us. And here product hierarchy will be the key product is an ordered listing of jobs based on their value to the organization. And the hierarchy not only provides information about which jobs are most and least valued, but it also provides information about the relative amount of difference between jobs which are there. Right? For example, here we have the job of vice president, you have the job of chief scientist or heads, for example, assembler one and assembler administrative assistants. First category We have managerial group called vice president, divisional managers, managers, project leaders, and supervisors. So job evaluation for them would be of a different kind. Head, chief scientist, senior associate scientist, scientist and technical. This is, you know, based on different kind of classification that is there. This is classification based, whereas manufacturing jobs are also classification based, whereas administrative jobs would be job evaluation based. So when fixing the salary, we have got to categorize the jobs as to where job evaluation will be available and where job classification will be available. Okay. Now the difference in the rates paid for different jobs and skills and affect the ability of managers to achieve their business objectives, and differences in pay matters. These matters of employees because their willingness to take on more responsibility in training. So focus on adding value for the customers and improving quality of products, and to be flexible enough to adapt challenges all depends on the least of the part and how pay structure be different from one level to another. Similarly, differences in rates paid for the different jobs. Job evaluation has evolved into many different forms, and no matter how job evaluation is designed, its ultimate use is to help design and manage work-related business focused. Right? Now, if we have done a job evaluation, and then just try and see as to what exactly happens. We said that market condition is one factor that will be associated with, along with the job evaluation, where we have got compensable value assigned to different factors as we listed education and responsibility and so on and so forth. Now here, as far as the market conditions are concerned, we consider two things. Number one, the demand and supply factor will be considered. If demand of a particular job is more and supply to that position is less, obviously the value of that job will be higher. But supply today, we said, is affected with the quality of manpower that is available for the particular job. Same designation is being given in different organizations, whereas the salary level differs with the quality of manpower who are employed on that job. And I gave the example of graduates of premier institutions joining a business organization, although designation-wise, it will be same as other organizations, but salary-wise, sometimes the difference is as much as 50 times to 40 to 50 times that is there. And therefore, we have got to consider when supply and demand in relation to the quality of the supply and the demand which is also there. And if the demand is less and supply is more, then also this factor operates. But for the quality graduates or the quality employees, it does not have much effect. Similarly, we have got conditions where your market condition is such that there is increased inflation in the market. Obviously, the salary paid will be fixed to be higher because you have got to take into consideration the cost of living which is available. Similarly, the Minimum Wages Act restricts that you cannot pay below a certain amount of money. Now, if you look at 7th Pay Commission when it came into existence, the minimum pay, minimum wages that had to be paid as far as government regulation is concerned was 18,000 rupees per annum. Right? Now, this money was revised and the demand was that it has to be increased to minimum 28,000 rupees, but that did not happen. And it is still under consideration. As far as the minimum wage is concerned, it stands at 18,000 rupees per annum that has to be paid to an employee as the minimum wage. Similarly, we also look at the competitors who are operating in the market, because if your competitors are paying more for similar position, then it will be difficult for you to retain your employee. It will be difficult for you to attract quality employees to the organization. And therefore, while fixing the wages, we have to see as to competitors' payment as to what it is. And you have got to match that value, if not increase it more than that. Similarly, if you look at the capacity of the organization to pay, if the organization does not have money to pay the employees, whatever may be the factor, will they be able to pay the employees? Answer is no. The capacity of the employee is dependent on how much is the cost involved and how much profit those organizations are making. In accordance with that, wages will be fixed. A loss-making organization may not be offering a very high salary for whatever reason it is. Now, if these are the factors, let us see as to how government fixed wages as far as these employees are concerned. How do they fix the wages? The governmental organizations. Let us first look at the sixth pay commission before we get to seventh, because not many changes are there in the sixth pay commission as far as we know. So let us look at the sixth pay commission as to how it was constituted. The sixth pay commission, as we all know, was constituted as per decision of the fifth pay commission that recommended that sixth pay commission should be constituted by 2003 so that its recommendations are available by 2006. Before I go further, pay commission used to come every 10th year, but the seventh pay commission and the present government abolished the pay commission. They said there will be no further pay commission after the seventh pay commission. So what we have is that sixth pay commission was from the 2006 and the fifth pay commission was from 1986, and one before that was of course 1966, and we go further down. But the sixth pay commission was constituted on the 5th of October 2006 and given 18 months to submit report. That was by 31st of March 2008. The sixth pay commission had the following members. There was Justice N. Krishna, who was the chairman. We had Ravin Dholakia, who was professor at IIM Ahmedabad, as a member. We had J.S. Mathur. He was also from an institute. This is S.M.T. Sushmanath, who was member secretary, a civil servant. And they were aided by the secretariat of 17 officers. They were mostly civil servants from related to finance of ministry. The members of sixth CPC visited 17 countries in around 18 months' time to study as to what is happening in different countries. The salient features was that implementation of the pay commission scales would be from 1/1/2006. The implementation of allowances and responsibility from date will be recommended by the government, and that was from 2008. To remove stagnation, induction of running pay band for all posts which had fixed pay of 26,000 was to be done. And total grades reduced from 35 to 22 running across four pay bands. That was pay band 1 to pay band 4, with distinctive grade pays allotted to each pay band. The group B categories to be upgraded to group C categories. Initially, existing employee was to be placed in pay scale of 1S, and for the purpose of initial fixation, Group B staff who already possesses the minimum qualification, which was high school, of to be placed in pay band 1 with effect from 1/1/2006, and those who do not possess the required qualification, they will be placed in pay band 1 at a lower level. Now, new structure was that we had a pay band, new pay band, where one S was there, who became a multi-skilled employee. So all people who's working as Khalasi, Safai Wala, Gangman 3 or Safai Wala, they were all placed under, or peons, they were all placed under one S. So we have got pay band 1, those who had minimum qualification, they were gangmen, artisan grade 3, or workmates, the artisan grade 2, artisan grade 1, right? We also had pay band 2, where grade pay was from 4,200 to 5,200, and pre-revised scale was 5,000 to 8,000, to 8,000 to 13,500. They all fell under pay band 2. Now, there were 7 different old designations, S9 to S15, where junior engineers, grade 2, junior engineer, grade 1, SE, OS, SES, and COS, assistant scale officer, assistant scale officers, after 3 years of, for 80% of the officers, 20% would be left out. Pay band 3 was 15,500 to 39,100, and the grade pay was 5,200 to 8,400. Here all, S16 to S26 people were included. We had senior scale people, we have J grade, and we have selection grade people, all fell under this particular category as far as the grade pay is concerned. Similarly, we had pay band 4, which has 39,200 to 67,000, and apex pay scale of 80,000 fixed, and cabinet secretary equivalent of 9,000 fixed was there. They had GP of 9,000 to 13,000, and old designation was S28 to S34. They were SAG and PHOD, AGM, GMs, and board members all fell under this particular category. For the teaching personnel and the university system, there was separate commission that was constituted by the UGC as per past practices. Now, the pay fixation in this CPC was as per the table 2.2.2. The reports have been given for table fixation that is given. This is the table. It's difficult to read until you see it closely as to what was the pre-revised pay and what would be the revised pay as per the grades available. For example, if you look at pay band 4, wherever people were getting 22,400 of pre-revised, revised pay was fixed at 48,990. Grade pay of 11,000 was added. So the scale would become 59,990 as far as this is concerned, right? Whereas for the other category where it was 24,052, revised pay was 52,770 in the senior scale. Grade pay was 13,000 rupees, and the basic would be 65,720. All DA would be added, all HRA would be added on top of this. So, formula for fixation was generally the following formula has been adopted. They say that there was, the commission worked out a multiplier for existing basic multiplied by 1.74, rounded off to nearest 10, what was the new basic. So whatever was the scale earlier, that was to be multiplied with a multiplier of 1.78. For example, if you look at the pay of 18,000 basic, right, what would be the rounded off pay for the new pay in the band? Yeah, the multiplier is 1.74. Can anybody calculate and tell me? The basic pay of 8,000 rupees, that was to be multiplied by 1.74, and the new basic would become 13,920, and 8,000 had a grade pay of 6,200. So you will add 6,200 as grade pay. So new basic will be 20,120, right? And if you have to add the HRA in a metropolitan city, which was 30%, so you will have further multiplier of 1.3, and that will come down to be 26,156 will be the basic pay of the individual in this particular grade that is there. Now, so what we find is that this multiplier was to be worked out as far as the minimum pay is concerned. Now, that is how it was worked out, and then the fixation was done by this particular method using the multiplier of 1.74. Now, what is to be noted is that multiplication factor of 1.74 is adopted considering 50% of DRNS pay and 24% of DA as on 1/1/2006. So if we worked out that the DA was merged, that is only 50%, and we said that 26,000 was the basic, so what it's plus HRA, we will be adding to this the total amount, and the total amount after adding DA will come up to 50% of DA, that will be 39,000 will be the basic pay. With that, you will also add a DA which stood at 24%. So we will have 24% of DA being added. So the amount will come down to 48,360 plus for a metropolitan city, you will have a 4,500 rupees added to this. So a gross pay for somebody who had a scale of 8,000 rupees earlier, the new joinees will get 52,860 rupees of basic pay, out of which the tax will be deducted, PF contribution will be deducted, the other contributions like insurance and other things will be deducted, and leftover amount will be the net pay that will be payable to the individuals in their bank accounts, right? So an 8,000 rupees basic, then with a grade pay of 6,200, the new, gross pay would be 52,860 that was worked out by this particular definition that is there. So it should have, if you add everything, it will be 1.86 that they have worked out as far as this multiplier is concerned. Now the formula for fixation that they worked out was grade pay was equal to maximum of scale into 40% rounded off to the nearest 100. Where two scales are merged, the maximum of the largest scale was considered so that advantage is to the employee who was going to get it. The minimum salary in pay band 1 was 48,600 plus 18,000 of grade pay. That was 6,660. Considering 3 units, a maximum of cabinet secretary equivalent of 19,000 per month, which is 1:13.35, that was increasing to 1:11.76 in the 5th CPC, instead of reducing this gap, is a socialistic society that they consider. So every post barring secretary equivalent and joint secretary equivalent has the grade pay attached to it, and that grade pay determines the status of the post, with senior post given a higher grade pay which is there. So annual increment was worked out to be 2.5% in the 6th pay commission, but 7th pay commission talked about an annual increment of 3% which is being given today. Further, they said that another form of variable increment for group 1 officers, those who fell in pay band 2 and 3, where 20% of high performers will be given increment at a higher rate of 3.5%. The government advised to extend this scheme to pay band 1 and pay band 2 as well. So an incentive was there for the high performers, that their increment per annum would not be 2.5%, but it would be 3.5%. And they further said that at the time of promotion from one post to another, the grade pay attached to the post in different levels within the same running band to change, one increment to be given at the time of promotions. So as and when a person was promoted and his salary was to be fixed, one notional increment was added to arrive at the minimum level of fixation of pay. The allowances will be based on grade pay, and allowances will increase by 25% when DA increases to 50%. That's what they said. And a person is stagnating at the maximum of the scale for more than a year. Now, that continuously to be placed in the next higher pay band without any change in the grade pay. So if somebody was in a grade, lower grade, and he has stagnated in that and not earned promotion, he will be given the next grade without giving them the designation. Now, DA was calculated with reference to All India Consumer Price Index for industrial workers. That was the percentage increase in is calculated from index of January 96, i.e. 306.33, that is 1982, a level of 100% formula was adopted. Similarly, before a merger of DA, 12 months average index minus 306.33 divided by 306.33 into 100 was being the formula. After merger of DA of 12 months, that was worked out. And the present method of calculation of DA base is called Lespierre's fixed base methodology that they adopted as far as this calculation of sixth pay commission was concerned. Economic theories postulate that if a price of commodity increases vis-a-vis other goods, the consumer adjusts his consumption basket to buy less of the goods, the price of which have increased more and more of the goods, and the pieces of which has increased lesser and that has fallen. But this is not applicable to lower grade pay, where they spend a majority of amount on foodstuffs and the price of these items has been increasing continuously, that is there. They further said that the dearness allowances was to switch over to chain-based technique in calculation of index, inflation and sixth pay commission, followed that chain effect. Till such time, the government keeps revising the base year in the existing fixed basic index method as frequently as possible. The base should be switched from 1982 to 2001 as 100% that was there. We further find that no merging of DA with basic pay at any stage was the incremental value that was assigned. Now, the allowances that was to be paid to the central government employees was as given in the table. In the revised scale, revised city classification of the population, that was being done first. The cities with 50 lakhs and more, the revised classification of cities was X, which was earlier A1 cities, and they will have an HRA of 30%. Now, in the 7 pay commission, this HRA of 30% has been reduced to 24%, and they said that once the DA increases to 50%, it will be scaled to 30% once again in terms of the HRA. All those cities which had the population of 5 lakhs and below 50 lakhs, which was earlier considered as Y city, was graded as Y city, which was earlier considered as A city, B1 city and B2 city, cities like Aligarh, which falls under this particular category. And it will have HRA of 20%, 7th pay commission has decreased it to 16%, and the same formula that once the inflation increases or DA increases to 50%, that will be scaled up to 20%. All those cities which was having population less than 5 lakhs, which was earlier called C-grade cities, was considered as Z-type cities. So now the classification is XYZ cities rather than ABC, that was there. And the rates of HRA, that is house rent allowances to be paid, was 20%, 30%, 20% and 10%. We said in the 7th pay commission, if you could note, has been reduced to 24%, 16% and 8% for the C grade type city, which is city Z now. Now, they further said that transport allowances were to be paid. In the 5th pay commission, we had transport allowance plus city compensatory allowance, CCA. CCA was abolished and merged with transport allowance. Now, the 6th pay commission said that employee drawing grade pay of 5,200. It is related to grade pay, not the pay band that is there. Now, in A1 cities and A-class cities, that was earlier. So they said that those persons who was having grade pay of 5,200 to 4,800 rupees, sorry, 5,200 grade pay, and including apex grade and cabinet secretary grade, would get 3,200 plus day on that will be added, right? And the other cities, it will be 1,600 rupees and DA thereof. Those persons falling in 4,200 to 4,800 in the X class city will be 1,600 plus DA thereon, and other cities was worked out to be 8,000, and below 4,200 was 400 and 300 respectively, depending on the city. This is for transport allowance. Now, earlier they said that the person must be residing at least 1 kilometer from the place of work, but later on this was being abolished. But all those people who were living in the governmental accommodation were not paid any HRA, but they were paid the transport allowance as per the rate. Physically handicapped people was to get 1,000 rupees additional, and that was there. Officers in pay band 4 was to get a higher amount as far as this particular system is concerned. Now, what we have is travel entitlement while on tours and travel. When these people were assigned to go to other cities for work and they were on duty, so they said that employee drawing 9,000 and above as grade pay was entitled for J class air travel or AC first class in train or AC2 in Rajdhani Express, and that is there. Those persons who were drawing the grade pay of 6,600 to 8,400, they were entitled for a Y class air travel plus AC 2 tier in train, AC 3 tier in Rajdhani. Those persons drawing 4,200 to 4,800 was entitled for AC 2 tier. They were not entitled for air travel. Those drawing 4,200 to 4,800, they were entitled for AC 2 tier train. And 4,200 was allowed first class AC 3 tier ticket and AC chair car by train. That is available on the route. No change for travel outside India was incorporated here. In case of road travel between places connected by rail travel by any means of public transport is allowed, provided the fare by train for class entitlement is not exceeded. So if somebody was to travel to Delhi, for example, from Aligarh, it is connected by train, so they were supposed to travel by train. However, if they were traveling by taxi or if they were traveling by the public transport, that was allowed. But for taxi, they had to seek special permission. Otherwise, the amount would not be paid to them. In case of road travel between places not connected by rail, all entitlement was for AC2 tier and above in train and deluxe ordinary buses for those entitled for first class and air travel. Sorry, Now, entitlement for daily allowances. Yes. Okay. All right. Thank you for reminding. Thank you.
Sir, next class is there.
I'll continue with this. Thank you.